This video is a recording of the third webinar in the SGD webinar series, titled Exploring Your Favorite Genes with SGD's Genome Browser. Please enjoy. All right. Hello and welcome, everybody. My name is Kevin McPherson. I'm an assistant biocurator for the Saccharomyces Genome Database, SGD. In today's webinar, third in the SGD webinar series, we're going to be having a really quick overview on how to use SGD's Genome Browser to explore the Escherichia genome. Anytime throughout the webinar, if you have any questions, please submit them through the Q&A button on the right-hand side of the BlueJeans page, which is shown by the red arrow. During the webinar, our moderators will answer your questions as they come in, and we'll also be having a Q&A session at the end, so please be sure to stick around for that if you have any more questions. So SGD represents the Escherichia genome with JBrowse. Just to give some background on this tool, JBrowse is a JavaScript-based genome browser that enables you to explore around the genome Google Maps style, where you can just click and scroll around smoothly without any page breaks or transitions. Using JBrowse, you can explore all of SGD's annotated genes and chromosomal features for the S288C strain. Additionally, you can compare these features to the many data tracks we provide in JBrowse, which are visual representations of actual published experimental data on Escherichia. So here's a screenshot of the S288C reference sequence and chromosomal features data tracks. Other data tracks in SGD's JBrowse represent things like transcription factor binding sites, nucleosome positioning, polyadenylation sites, and a whole lot more. These data tracks can be compared to the reference sequence and to one another, helping you visualize and infer about actual yeast biology. To access SGD's JBrowse, on the SGD homepage at yeastgenome.org, just open the Sequence tab in the toolbar that runs across the top of the homepage and click on Genome Browser, as shown by the red arrow. JBrowse can also be accessed from any locus summary page on SGD, so here's the locus summary page for Gal1. In the Sequence section, just click on the JBrowse link shown by the red circle to be taken to that specific locus in our Genome Browser. Lastly, you can access JBrowse by typing in the URL yeastgenome.org/browse. In today's webinar, we'll start by going over how to navigate JBrowse. Then, we'll investigate a couple of biological questions that can be answered simply by navigating the genome. Next, we'll go over how to use data tracks in JBrowse and see what we can visualize by comparing them to the S288C reference sequence. Lastly, we'll be answering your questions in our Q&A session at the end of the webinar. So let me just open SGD's JBrowse, again, at yeastgenome.org/browse. The UI can seem a little messy right now, but it's actually pretty simple. So let's start just by breaking down the UI. The main display, here, is where all of your active data tracks are shown. Right now, I have two data tracks enabled, reference sequence, which is the DNA sequence of the S288C. Note that we actually can't see the sequence yet because we're not zoomed in enough. And the second data track, S288C, this data track, maps out all of the genes and chromosomal features annotated by SGD. These data tracks are pretty fundamental to genome browsing, so SGD enables these tracks by default. For more data tracks, you'll have to use the Select Tracks button, which is shown here. More on that later in the webinar. Right above the main display, here, is everything that has to do with navigation. The chromosomal location box, which is shown here, tells us that we're currently looking at a 26 kilobase section of chromosome 1. The overview bar, which is right above it here, shows us just exactly where this 26 kilobase section is and how big it is in relation to the whole chromosome. As mentioned earlier, the section we're looking at is too big currently to see the actual nucleotide sequence. To zoom in, click on the plus sign magnifying glasses. Or just in the main display, double-click over a region of interest. The best and most precise way to zoom, however, is to hold down the Shift button and drag your mouse over the region you want to see. So now, as you can see, we're zoomed in close enough to see the actual nucleotide sequence. To zoom back out, use the minus sign, magnifying glasses, or enter the overview bar and select a large region with your mouse. To scroll around the genome, just click and drag your mouse to the left or right, or use the arrow keys on your keyboard. If you've used GBrowse before, you'll be happy to know that there are no page breaks in JBrowse. You can just keep scrolling. You can just keep scrolling to one end or the other of the chromosome without having to stop. So finding a particular gene or chromosomal feature would be pretty difficult just by scrolling around the genome. Luckily, the chromosomal location box also functions as a search box. Just enter a gene of interest, like Gal10, and click on Go. JBrowse will take you to that gene and just show it on the main display, like here. So we entered in Gal10, and now Gal10 is being presented to us right in the center here. That pretty much covers navigation in JBrowse. Since we stopped at the gene Gal10, let's answer some biological questions using the navigation methods we went over. So some questions you can answer simply by just navigating include, where is Gal10 located in the genome? What is the Gal10 nucleotide sequence? And what genes are within proximity to Gal10? To find out where Gal10 is located in the genome and what nucleotide sequence it has, just click on the gene. JBrowse will produce a window that gives you some more information on it. So here we see that Gal10 is encoded on chromosome 2, what its coordinates are, and that it's on the minus strand and is 2100 base pairs long. The region sequence section, which is right over here, displays the Gal10 nucleotide sequence and provides the option to save the sequence as a FASTA file. If you wanted more information, just follow the link here, which will take you to the Gal10 locus summary page on the SGD website. To find out the closest genes to Gal10, all we have to do is just zoom out. Given that Gal10 is encoded on the minus strand, here we see that the closest gene to Gal10's 3' end is Gal7, and the closest gene to Gal10's 5' end is Gal1. So we uncovered a lot of stuff just by scrolling around the Gal10 gene. We learned that Gal10 is encoded on chromosome 2, is 2100 base pairs long, and is flanked by Gal7 and Gal1. Let me zoom in real quick on Gal10 and Gal1. Here we see that these genes are transcribed in opposite directions, and we can also examine their well-known promoter region. Gal10 and Gal1 are pretty interesting, especially with their shared promoter, so let's try and visualize more about the transcriptional regulation of these genes. Here are some things that JBrowse can help us examine. What transcription factors bind to the Gal10-Gal1 promoter? How are nucleosomes involved in regulating Gal10-Gal1 transcription? And how does the expression of Gal10 and Gal1 change in the presence of galactose? To visualize transcription factor binding sites and nucleosome positioning, we'll have to enable some data tracks. So as mentioned before, data tracks are how JBrowse represents experimental data. To add data tracks, click on the Select Tracks button. This will open a menu that contains all of the data tracks offered by SGD's JBrowse. These tracks are organized into the different categories shown on the left side of the page here and include assay type, general biological category, and more. As a side note, users who are familiar with SGD's old genome browser, GBrowse, might be happy to note that we have a section here, as shown where my mouse currently is, that splits up the JBrowse data tracks according to our old GBrowse categories. So to answer questions about transcription factors, we should enter the transcription category and find data tracks related to transcription factor binding sites. Track titles, over here, suggest what a particular track might be about. Let's enable this track since it's titled TF-ChipChip. Just check the box for this track and click on Back to Browser. Any new tracks you enabled will be displayed at the bottom here. To find out more about the track we just enabled, and verify the kind of data you're seeing in it, enter the track title bar and click on About This Track. This will open up a window that gives us some background about the track. So here we see that this one is about the binding locations of 203 regulatory proteins across the 3 yeast genome, which is precisely what we were looking for. Other information provided in this window include the source, authors, and institution, the type of assay performed, and a link to the SGD website where you can download the original dataset. So it appears that several binding sites are shown which overlap and concern two proteins, GAL80 and GAL4. A quick search on the SGD website reveals that GAL4 is a transcription factor that induces expression of GAL1 and GAL10, while GAL80 is a transcriptional regulator that binds to GAL4 when galactose is absent and prevents it from activating GAL10 and GAL1. So given that GAL80 binds to GAL4, it would make sense that they localize together in this data track. So that pretty much answers our first question about transcription factors. Let's find out about nucleosomes by enabling more data tracks. I'll just open the Select Tracks tab over here and clear all my current filters. To find data tracks that concern nucleosome occupancy, select the chromatin organization category. One way to filter which tracks are shown is to just type in a keyword in the text field here. I'll go ahead and search for nucleosome, which will limit the tracks in chromatin organization to those that contain the word nucleosome somewhere. Having seen some of these tracks before, I'll go ahead and enable these two tracks here, which come from a paper by Dr. Kaplan. As before, to confirm what's being shown at a data track, enter the track title bar and select about this track. This data track, the one at the top from the two that we just enabled, is about nucleosome occupancy levels for yeast grown in YPD, or a type of complete media. While this data track is about nucleosome occupancy for yeast grown in galactose. Right now, we're concerned with nucleosome occupancy in the GAL10, GAL1 promoter region. So to make comparing these data tracks to the GAL10, GAL1 promoter easier, let's highlight the promoter with a highlight feature here. So we see that for yeast grown in YPD, there is significant nucleosome occupancy in the GAL10, GAL1 promoter. In the presence of galactose, however, this track shows us that there's very low nucleosome occupancy. So the picture that JBrowse is painting for us is the well-known understanding that in the presence of galactose, nucleosomes are displaced from the GAL10, GAL1 promoter, and GAL4 induces expression of GAL10 and GAL1. In the absence of galactose, nucleosomes occupy the GAL10, GAL1 promoter, and GAL80 binds to GAL4, causing reduced expression of GAL10 and GAL1. By the way, one cool thing that you can do about JBrowse is that you can save whatever you're looking at and come back to it later. All you have to do is just copy the URL and store it somewhere. In fact, this URL is shareable with other people, so if you find something interesting, you can show it to your colleagues. To demonstrate this, I've recently put the JBrowse link in the chat section for the screen in BlueJeans. If you just open up the chat box on the right-hand side of the page, you'll see a link. If you just click on that link, it will take you to JBrowse, and you'll see what I'm currently displaying in this webinar. So if you follow that link, you can check out everything we've been looking at. So one more thing that I want to show you is that if you are interested in learning more about the nucleotide sequence of the GAL10, GAL1 promoter, something you could do is just download the nucleotide sequence itself. An easy way to do this is just to download the nucleotide sequence of the region that you have currently displayed. To do this, just zoom into the region you want to download, then enter the reference sequence track, click on Save Track Data, and keep the Visible Region option checked. Then just click Save. This will export the sequence of the region you're viewing as a FASTA file. So that concludes our webinar. Thank you for coming, and please be sure to keep an eye out for our follow-up email for more information about JBrowse, our next webinar, and the link to our YouTube channel where today's webinar will be uploaded. So thank you again, and let's go ahead and start our Q&A session.
Thank you for watching the SGD webinar series. If you have any questions or comments, please contact us at sgd-helpdesk@lists.stanford.edu.